In a moment, I will introduce Dr. Gilbert and later the mayor, who will preside during our proclamation phase tonight. But first, let me acknowledge several of the distinguished guests. Mike Farrell, former interim president of Marshall, former member of the Marshall Board of Governors, and now vice chair of the West Virginia Higher Education Policy Commission. Mike? Dr. Corley Dennison, former undergraduate dean at Marshall, dean of journalism and mass communications, and now vice chancellor of academic affairs at HEPC. I haven't seen Ken Sullivan yet, but did he make it? Thank you. Ken Sullivan is executive director of the West Virginia Humanities Council. Thank you. And I haven't seen the superintendent yet, so I don't, is he here? Oh, there he is. Blind as a bat. Kebbell County School Superintendent Bill Smith. County Commissioner Jim Morgan. Bishop Sam Moore. Bishop Moore was the first recipient of the Drinko Academy's Carter G. Woodson Award. Kyle and Kayla Dyer. I saw Kyle. There's Kayla. Kyle and Kayla are two of my former students who mailed me their wedding invitation using a Woodson postage stamp. Theirs was the real thing. Dr. Bill Bissett, the former senior vice president at Marshall and now the president of the Huntington Regional Chamber of Commerce. And I'm looking for Emma Gui. I don't see Emma. Okay. Emma is the artist who produced the winning entry in the Black History poster contest, and all of you have a copy of her work on the cover of tonight's program. Because Alan Gould can't make it tonight, he asked me as a member of the Drinko Academy to recognize all of the Drinko Fellows. Would you all please stand and be recognized? Before we get too far into tonight's program, I should remind all of you why we're here. This is the opening ceremony for the 2017 Black History Month. It is also an occasion for us to remember Dr. Woodson's Huntington and West Virginia roots. Let me now introduce Dr. Gilbert, who jointly announced creation of the Lyceum with Dr. Gould on January 20th. Dr. Gilbert has been president for a little more than a year, but already his leadership has set a tone for zero tolerance for discrimination and championed diversity and inclusion. In case you're wondering, I believe Dr. Woodson would approve. Dr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Bernice. I'm truly honored to be here tonight at this special occasion to honor Dr. Carter G. Woodson. Dr. Woodson is truly an admirable figure in our nation's history, a scholar and a son of former slaves. He was at the forefront of bringing African-American history to light. He escaped poverty through education, ultimately receiving his doctorate from Harvard in 1912. Dr. Woodson certainly embodied the notion that education and increasing social and professional contacts among blacks and whites could reduce racism, and he promoted an organized study of black history partly for that purpose. To that end, I've been asked tonight to speak a few minutes about the importance of education to bridging divides. And I want to start with a very personal story. A few of you may have heard this before, and if you have, please bear with me. But I grew up in the Deep South in the era of Jim Crow. And when I was in junior high school, my school was integrated in the spring of 1970. My white English teacher at mid-year was replaced by Mrs. Beatrice Moore, a black English teacher from another junior high school. She was a graduate of Jackson State University in my hometown. From a very early age, I'd seen how people were treated differently and mistreated simply because of the color of their skin. I saw the impact of segregation and what it had on our population and how it negatively impacted our community and our society. But honestly, I wasn't sure what to expect from that English class because I had never been around an educated black person to that point in my life. But for some reason, Mrs. Moore took a liking to me, and I quickly learned to respect and to love Mrs. Moore. She changed the way I saw the world. Mrs. Moore changed my world. And let me say that again, she changed my world. All it took was getting to know one person who disproved all the unspoken rules about black people being inferior to whites. If it had not been for Mrs. Moore, it would have been someone else probably later on, but I have always felt extraordinarily fortunate that destiny brought her to me in my class in Mississippi in 1970. At my presidential investiture ceremony last September, I referred to the notion of America being a city on a hill. It was, of course, an idea that was originally expressed by the Puritan John Winthrop in a sermon in 1630. It's a beautiful vision because each of us can picture that in our mind, a bright, shining city raised above us. It's a powerful vision, something that we should aspire for. And I'd like to borrow that metaphor for the purpose of this celebration of Dr. Woodson and education as a bridge to divides. It is particularly timely, I think, in the current political and social climate of our country. I firmly believe that our best years are still ahead of us and that education is indeed the key to achieving that shining city on a hill. Educated people must lead the way and stand up for what is right. Educated people will bring about the positive actions that will reveal that shining city. There are many changes on the horizon, and higher education, of course, will be evolving as well. The changing demographics of America's citizens are going to change the face of higher education, and that face will be more diverse and a mix of many cultures. It will be less white. This makes it even more important than ever to have in place programs that address acceptance and respect. We're making it a priority here at Marshall to aggressively combat racism and discrimination at every turn. We are expanding our programming for students, faculty, and staff in our community in Huntington to raise awareness and provide people with the tools they need to grow professionally and to face the changes ahead with anticipation and not fear. We are encouraging open dialogue and civil discourse about the matters that threaten to divide us. We are challenging each person to be part of the solution. It's education. It's all about education. So often since I've arrived at Marshall, I've found inspiration in the Marshall Creed, and I'm very proud of the creed that we have at our university. The creed draws its foundation on the character of John Marshall, and I invoked the creed in the spring semester when releasing a statement about free speech when some political messages were chalked on the university sidewalks. You may remember that. John Marshall stood for protecting individual rights and for interpreting the Constitution so everyone could benefit from the rights and privileges outlined in it. He stood for justice and respect. The Creed lists a number of statements that define the Marshall community. It says that we are an educational community, an open community, a civil community, a responsible community, a well community, an ethical community, a pluralistic community, a socially conscious community, and a judicious community. I think these are characteristics that we can be very proud of as an institution. During my investiture remarks, I built on the Marshall Creed and expressed some aspirational traits and characteristics that we would want repeated and affirmed by all our graduates, the sons and daughters of Marshall. And I think these are fitting sentiments with which to close this evening. So listen as I describe who we want to be, we the sons and daughters of Marshall. We are seekers of the truth, not people who tolerate lies and injustice. We are lifetime learners, not complacent graduates. We are readers and thinkers, not blind followers of rhetoric. We embrace the light. We are not the ones who hide in the darkness. We turn the cheek. We don't return violence. We surround ourselves with diversity. We don't shut out people because they're different. We find solutions. We don't contribute to problems. We are defenders of justice, not ones who shrink from challenges. We speak up for those without voices. We are not the ones who sit in silence. We share what we have. We do not hold greedily onto what is ours. We love knowledge, and we are not afraid of new ideas. We look to the future with hope. We do not dread the worst. We know we will succeed. We are not fearful of failing. We are destined for greatness. We are the sons and daughters of Marshall. I'm grateful to be with you here this evening, and I thank you for your attention.
I would like to share with you some comments Dr. Woodson made in his 1949 annual report about the upcoming 1950 Negro History Week, just before he died. Dr. Woodson said, "The celebration of Negro History Week is scheduled for the 7 days beginning February 12th. The date is determined by the necessity to cover the birthdays of Lincoln on the 12th, and the supposed birthday of Douglas on the 14th. He did not know exactly when he was born, but he requested that he be remembered on Valentine's Day because he was his mother's Valentine. Lincoln was the embodiment of freedom for all men, and Douglas was the exponent of the idea of making that freedom count in the attainment of civil rights. The celebration, when properly observed, is a patriotic manifestation, and all exercises to the contrary are discouraged. Now I'd like to introduce the mayor, who will issue a proclamation and preside over the other statements that will be brought to you. Mayor Steve Williams is one of the architects of the Carter G. Woodson Day, and we have strong support from him in all issues related to Woodson and the Lyceum. I'd like to repay the mayor in some small way. Perhaps the Lyceum can be the mayor's safe haven, hideout, or escape after he releases his 2018 fiscal budget. And yes, the Lyceum has a physical home, which we will unveil in the not too distant future. Please welcome Mayor Steve Williams.
Ernest brings, prior to the city's statement, the mayor's State of the City address, brings his journalism class in prior to the meeting to have a discussion with me about what the budget is going to look like. He's trying to get a scoop tonight. One thing that I was pleased to see there, that this room is packed. So, Pastors Bishop, let's pass the plate around. We could use all the help that we could get in Huntington tonight. It's an honor to be able to be here on the first night honoring Dr. Carter G. Woodson. We had this conversation a couple of years ago. What we keep trying to say to anybody who will listen to us in Huntington is that you can get there from here. Huntington is in the center of the world. You can get there from here. And Carter G. Woodson demonstrated that in so, so many ways. The fact that our nation recognizes Black History Month during the month of February, Huntington, West Virginia, Marshall University must own Black History Month because of Carter G. Woodson. That's why it's so absolutely important that we begin this month on this night and have a month of festivities. Now, fact is, when we look at the history of our city, we mirror so many cities because we have been a city of division, of racial divide. And even all these years later, 146 years after our founding, we're still realizing that we have an awful long way to go. Isn't it interesting that the street that we have, the main route that we have entering into our city, right to the heart of Marshall University, the heartbeat of our city, named after a famed athlete, Hal Greer, whether it be Hal Greer Boulevard or in years past known as 16th Street, the major artery coming into the heart of the city, also was the major artery that split one of the more less diverse neighborhoods within our community. Right down the heart of the Fairfield community, splitting it right in two. There would be some who would say, as you look back at this history, that was not an accident. Fact of the matter is, we in this community, anybody who is involved within the community, can use that artery as a lifeline for our city. Isn't it interesting? Dr. Carter G. Woodson, with his history of education and excellence as a past principal of Douglas High School. Years later, for the last principal of Douglas High School was Joe Slash. You can get there from here, because one of my heroes is Joe Slash's son, Joe Slash Jr., who was the deputy mayor of the city of Indianapolis, just recently retired from being president of the Urban League in Indianapolis. He never says goodbye to Huntington. He's in constant contact with what we have here in Huntington. And isn't it fitting that this very year that a man who stood in his shadows is embarking upon his own retirement, our own Mr. Bill Smith, superintendent of schools here. Because I neglected to say, while Joe Slash was the last student principal of Douglas High School, he was also a superintendent of schools in Cabell County. Think about it. Within a couple of generations, a community that is divided by race places our greatest and our most precious asset under the leadership of two black men. And a black man places the entire nation and sets them for this entire nation forward that we must recognize and acknowledge the significance of African American history, of black history. It starts in Huntington, West Virginia. You can get there from here. So with that, it's my honor on behalf of the citizens of Huntington to offer this proclamation. Whereas Dr. Carter Godwin Woodson, 1875 to 1950, is the father of African American history, a celebrated American educator and the son of former slaves whose parents helped build Huntington, West Virginia. Whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson, a former West Virginia coal miner who received his diploma from Huntington's Douglas High School, where he returned as principal 4 years later before beginning his journey to the Philippines as a school administrator and studying at the Sorbonne in Paris. And whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson studied at Harvard University and became the second African-American recipient of a PhD at that institution and the only son or daughter of former slaves to receive a doctorate in history from any university. And whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson, equipped with influences that included his Huntington background, created and led the modern black history movement, which began the restoration of African Americans to the history books from 1915 to 1950. And whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson established the first Negro History Week 90 years ago on February 7th, 1926, and the influence of his teachings have been used annually by the presidents of the United States in proclaiming February as African American History Month since President Gerald Ford. And whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson so ably taught Americans and the world about African-American contributions to history at a time when few people recognized their contributions. And whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson has left a legacy of speaking a fundamental truth to the world, that African-Americans and people of African descent are makers of history. Now, therefore, I, Steve Williams, mayor of the city of Huntington, Cabell, and Wayne counties, do hereby proclaim the first day of February 2017 to be Dr. Carter Godwin Woodson Day in the city of Huntington, and encourage all people, businesses, organizations, and institutions to join in honoring this distinguished individual. Bernice. We are honored as well to have other individuals who are our elected officials and representatives of some of our elected officials here to bring remarks. Senator Plannell texted me just a few moments ago. He offers his apologies for not being able to be here. We were just together an hour ago and saying we'll see each other in about 30 minutes, but circumstances developed with his family that he's not able to be here, and he does send his apologies. Delegate Sean Hornbuckle is a representative who we are extremely proud of. Delegate Hornbuckle is entering his second term in the West Virginia House of Delegates. He is an active and strong voice on behalf of Cabell and Wayne counties and certainly Marshall University. Here to bring remarks, Delegate Sean Hornbuckle.
First of all, wow. All the people in this room, it was just a year ago that we were over there in that beautiful atrium. And while it was a lot of people, it wasn't this. And this speaks volumes to, again, the progress that we're making. So first of all, give yourselves a hand. As Mayor Steve alluded to, the history, the rich history of our town, our city, Huntington, West Virginia, not only are we going to be talking about a great man, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, today, but it was around 1870 when his father moved here to help Cosby Huntington finish that C&O Railroad to develop what we now call Huntington. So it is only fitting that we're doing those things here today. With that being said, good evening. On behalf of the West Virginia Legislature and a lifelong resident of the community, I'm proud to honor Dr. Carter G. Woodson today, as well as congratulate all of us here as a community on the daughter, Dr. Carter G. Woodson Lyceum. I'd also like to thank Marshall University, Dr. Morris, Dr. Dooley, Dr. Dean Van Horn, Dr. Gould, Dr. Gilbert, the West Virginia Humanities Council, and everyone else that played a part in making this a reality. First, it's very important to know the meaning of the Lyceum. Inspired by the great Aristotle around 335 BC as a place for thinking and learning. Now obviously, with everything that is going on in the world today, this couldn't be a better time to have this. A yearning for deeper thinking, acceptance, understanding, equality, dare I say, freedom of expression and speech, or perhaps diversity and inclusion. An educated society is the only way to keep moving forward. Last year, this event also taught me a lot. And I'm one that always says that growing up, I didn't learn enough. And maybe as I got older and try to get into business and politics, maybe I stopped, you know, that thirst for that. But last year reinvigorated that thirst to learn more about what is everyone's history. So one of the things that I like to talk about, and I'm going to talk about a personal experience, we'll go with the legislature. Back in 2012, thinking about running for the West Virginia House, and there were a lot of things going through my mind, whether I wanted to do it, why some of these people were pushing me to run, can you raise any money to do this? How's that going to go? And then a couple of people of all walks of life said, well, you know, Sean, you are in West Virginia. How are you going to do this? So I embarked upon that path and I ran. And it gets close to the election and I'm doing all the legwork. And during that campaign and that election, and I remember that night coming out of the city of Huntington, I was actually beating all the incumbents at, I believe, 26 years old. And then came the vaunted Eastern Cabell County and Lincoln County. And then those numbers started to slip a little bit. And some of you all know in here, things didn't go as well for me personally that night. However, what did happen is some things that I already felt before is that a lot of things are not that people don't like each other, it's sort of the fear of the unknown. It's the fear of the unknown. And education will help to heal that void and that divide.
So what I did is I shed a couple of tears because I don't like to lose. But I went back to the drawing board. And when I went back to the drawing board, I made some of those trips out there where some people tell you not to go and that you're not wanted. I did that. Did that often. Did that a lot. 2 years passes by. Ended up winning the darn thing. Still didn't raise a whole bunch of money, but I won the thing. And excuse me to some of my fellow elected officials in here, but those are some of my best friends down there in Eastern Calvert County, in Lincoln County, and it's that whole thing of once they get to know you, it's okay. And those folks, and this is from their mouths, they like me a lot better than my white colleagues. So it is, you like that, didn't you, Bill Bissett? But it's the truth, because again, it's about education. We're all the same. It's the fear of not knowing, and the education will help that. So again, one of my legislative goals is with our education system is to make sure that we are promoting not just African American history, but Mexican American and Chinese American history as one, because it's all American history. And the more that you do that, that fear of not knowing goes away, and we're able to move forward. And that little kid that doesn't know any better, that's getting terrible instruction from somebody in his household, they no longer pay attention to that, because they know better. After this great symposium last year, again, my thirst for knowledge, I said, let's need to learn a little bit more, Hornbuckle. So I'm Googling stuff, and I kid you all not, some of you all might not know this, probably maybe everybody but me, I didn't know there was a White Panther Party. I didn't know that. They don't teach you that stuff in school. They don't teach you sometimes that, you know, there was actually a lot of white folks who understood what was crazy was going on and wanted to help. It's not all bad stuff. And learning that, it was a very, very good thing to know. Now, in true education fashion, as I wrap up here, all right, we're going to do sort of a pop quiz, all right? Now, some folks might know these people, but some might not. I think it'll be a good time for some enrichment. So raise your hand, or you can shout out the answer if you know. What was Lewis Latimer famous for? Shoelaces. But the light bulb, the carbon filament for the light bulb. Otis Boykin. Anybody Otis Boykin? God, I'm glad we're getting the Lyceum. The artificial heart pacemaker control unit. Henry Brown, anybody? Henry Brown. I know you're right. The modern day fireproof safe. Gerald Lawson. The modern home video gaming console. Mark Hanna. 3D graphics technology for films that we watch today. Lonnie Johnson. The Super Soaker. Frederick M. Jones. Mobile refrigeration. Charles Richard Drew, the blood bank. Thank you, Reverend Watts. Ludwig Marchand, a young gentleman that was born in 1991 and at the age of 21 actually invented what's called dry bath, and it is a lotion for folks that do not have proper access to water to be able to bathe. All right, so it's pretty cool. So, and all of that, just think, if kids know that that PS4 that I just bought for Christmas is way too much, all right, that a guy of color invented that, and a super soaker that I play in the summer with all my friends, they invented that, and all these other things, again, those stereotypes, all those things go away because they know that we're all equal. We're all equal. So in closing today, first of all, I want to thank you for your indulgence. But I also want to challenge you. And I don't say ask, I say challenge, because it's tough sometimes. It's tough sometimes to challenge the folks that you might work with or go to church with or do things with to think of things in a different light. And I want you to challenge yourself to keep up the fight. Keep up the fight. I also want you to challenge yourselves to always do what's right. I thank you all. I appreciate you all. God bless.
Son of Marshall, Governor Jim Justice isn't able to be with us tonight, but his heart does live within and beat for Marshall University as the entire state of West Virginia. Here to bring greetings appropriately is the new director of the Herbert Henderson Office of Minority Affairs, named after Attorney Herbert Henderson of Huntington, who helped so many individuals over the years, and through his family, his legacy continues to live. We're proud to bring greetings from Governor Justice, the new director of the Herbert Henderson Center for Minority Affairs, Dr. Bill White.
Good evening. This is quite an event. I'm really pleased to see so many of you out here today. And I'm also happy to tell you that we're in for a nice ride, I promise you that. I don't know how many of you know Joe Long, Attorney Joe Long. I see a lot of you shaking your heads, but he's in Dubai today on vacation. He called me and he said, and I hope he's right, he said, Bill, he says, you know, Herb Henderson was my hero and my mentor, he says, and he would be very proud to know that you are going to be walking into that position, and he said, I know that you're going to do well, and I don't want to let him down, I don't want to let Herb down, and I don't want to let any of you down. We have our hands full, and Mayor, you were absolutely right. It was interesting to hear you talk. I'm a native of West Virginia, even though I spent about 35 years in California, but my heart has always been here. And I was a research chemist, folks, and I was talking to some of you, she smiled and laughing. I was talking to some of you and I said, you know, God sent you in some really strange directions. And let me assure you, this is not Bill White that decided that this is where I was going to be. God did this. My preparation, I'm sure that a lot of what I've done has prepared me for this, but this is not something I would have thought that I would be doing in this part, this point of my life. But I'm very excited, and I guarantee you that we're going to be doing some exciting things. This is the first event that the governor is acknowledging tonight for Black History Month, and I think it's very appropriate that we're doing it here in Huntington. And I was looking at your activities and quite impressed with what all the events that you're having. I hope that the events that are on this sheet are as well attended as this event is tonight. So don't let this be your last time to come out in February, but don't let February be the only month that you celebrate the unity of our nation. Whether it's Black history or women's history or whatever, we really need to, as the mayor said, work together if we want to be successful as a state and as a nation. And you know, we have a $400 million deficit. And so we're all going to have to, in this state right now, and all of us are going to have to work very hard to make sure that we get what we need. And I'm going to put a big push in for education as well. I see another friendly face out there, a lot of friendly faces. But I'm going to put another pitch in for education. And I've said this to many of you. You know, I was a graduate dean for several years, and I've spent most of my time working in higher education. The state is not going to move until we get our arms around what we need to do for education, folks. And it's not always that four-year degree that we're talking about. It could be a two-year degree, it could be a certificate program, but you know, the days of being an eighth grade dropout making $25 an hour, they're gone forever. And I have been pretty much disheartened hear some of our politicians say, coal's coming back. Well, yeah, coal may come back, but the person who's going to be working in that mine is going to be an engineer with a bachelor's degree or a master's degree. It's not going to be that eighth grader who dropped out of high school. So we have to make sure that we do some reality checking, folks, and talk about what's going to happen here in West Virginia. You know, we hear all these things about who killed coal and what all this. I grew up in Bluefield, one of the boomiest cities in the nation back in the 50s and 60s. That's dying. It was dying when I was a kid because coal was being moved out of the state or the jobs were going. So this is not something that just happened, people. And we really do need to, if we're going to be successful as a state, we need to get all of our folks in this state involved, black, white, women, men, Asian, Hispanics, whatever, we have to get folks involved. So the only other thing I'll mention before I read these two proclamations is that on Monday at the Culture Center, we will be having our kickoff for Black History Month for the state. So I would invite all of you to come down and participate in that. That should be a nice event. So I'm here to represent the governor, and I would like to have two proclamations. So Dr. Morris, if you come forward, I'd like to give these to you. The first proclamation is by Governor Jim Justice. Whereas Carter Goodwin Woodson was born in Buckingham County, Virginia on December 19, 1875, the son of a former slave, James and Eliza Riddle Woodson, he moved to West Virginia as a young man to work in the coal mines in Fayette County, West Virginia. And whereas, although Woodson did not begin his formal education until he was 20 years old, when in 1985 he enrolled in Douglas High School in Huntington, West Virginia, he earned his high school diploma less than 2 years later. In 1903, he received a bachelor's degree from Brer College in Kentucky. In 1908, he received a master's degree from the University of Chicago. And in 1912, he received his PhD from Harvard, making him the second African-American and the first person of enslaved parents to receive a PhD in history. And whereas Woodson maintained a strong connection to West Virginia through his service to public schools throughout the state, he taught his high school in Winona, West Virginia. He was selected as principal of Douglas High School in Huntington, West Virginia, and he served as academic dean at West Virginia Collegiate Institute, now West Virginia State University, from 1920 to 1922. And whereas Woodson was a Sunday school teacher and president of the Board of Deacons of the First Baptist Church in Winona, and whereas, recognizing that black contributions to history were being ignored, Woodson began the modern black history movement in 1915. His greatest impact came when he founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, now called the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, ASALH. Under his pioneering leadership, the Association created research and publication outlets for black scholars. And whereas in 1926, Woodson initiated the celebration of Negro History Week, which expanded to include the entire month of February, and today is known as Black History Month. And whereas Woodson was a historian, author, and publisher who devoted his life to research and preserving the history of African Americans, he is known as the father of black history for his efforts for promoting African American history, and his works are now housed in the manuscript division of the Library of Congress, where they remain available for research today. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Jim Justice, governor of the great state of West Virginia, do hereby proclaim February 1, 2017, as Dr. Carter G. Woodson Day in the Mountain State, and encourage all citizens to join me in this observation and recognize that Dr. Woodson's contributions to our state and nation, in witness whereof I have hereunder set my hand and caused the great seal of West Virginia to be affixed, done at the Capitol, City of Charleston, West Virginia, this the first day of February in the year of our Lord, 2017, and in the 154th year of the Senate. Signature by Jim Justice, Governor, and by Mac Warner, Secretary of State.
Thank you very much. Stanford.
Governor, got this. Proclamation by Governor Jim Justice. Whereas West Virginia has been home of some of the country's most influential African-American scholars and leaders, and whereas Dr. Carter G. Woodson taught high school in Winona, West Virginia, was principal at Douglas High School in Huntington, West Virginia, served as academic dean at West Virginia Collegiate Institute, now West Virginia State University, and founded what is today's Black History Month. And whereas Dr. Leon Sullivan, born October 16, 1922 in Charleston, West Virginia, was the first African-American member of the board of directors at the General Motors Corporation, and his Sullivan principles played a key role in the downfall of apartheid. And whereas Booker T. Washington, raised in Malvern, West Virginia, founded Alabama's Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute in 1881 and was the foremost Black educator of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And whereas Henry Louis Gates, born in Piedmont, West Virginia in 1950, is a renowned educator, scholar, literary critic, and writer. And whereas the Herbert Henderson Office of Minority Affairs was established in 2012 by the West Virginia Legislature. And whereas Black History Month is a time set aside to reflect on the achievements of the African-American community and recognize the honor these contributions. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Jim Justice, Governor of the great state of West Virginia, do hereby proclaim February 2017 as Black History Month in the Mountain State and encourage all citizens to recognize the many contributions made by African-Americans in West Virginia and the nation. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused the Great Seal of West Virginia to be affixed. Done at the Capitol, Charleston, City of Charleston, State of West Virginia. This is the first day of February in the year of our Lord, 2017, and in the 154th year of the Senate. Signed by Jim Justice, Governor, and Mark Warner, Secretary of State.
Thank you. What a surprise.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Before joining the Mellon Foundation, Dr. Lewis served as Provost and Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs at Emory University. Several of us at the Draco Academy became aware of Dr. Lewis when he was Provost at Emory. Alan Gould and I watched a video recorded during the national meeting of the association that Woodson founded. At the meeting, Dr. Lewis introduced the speakers on a program about remembering Carter G. Woodson, including John Hope Franklin, a great historian in his own right, but known by some people as one of Woodson's boys. Alan Gould, a former Marshall provost, remarked that Dr. Lewis looked too young to be a provost. On a serious note, Dr. Lewis, Alan was one of the major forces behind keeping Woodson's connection to Huntington alive. He wanted very much to witness your presentation tonight, but he'll have to wait until we get him a video. A native of Tidewater, Virginia, Dr. Lewis is the author and co-author of 7 books. He earned an undergraduate degree in history and psychology from Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota, and a PhD in history from the University of Minnesota. He has been a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences since 2008. By the way, I told a friend, a dentist, sitting among you, that Emory University purchased the Woodson papers while Dr. Lewis was provost there. My friend, known for his extreme sense of humor, asked, "You mean Woodson didn't leave his papers to Marshall?" Well, perhaps Dr. Lewis will tell us why Emory got the Woodson papers and Marshall didn't. Please welcome Dr. Lewis.
I'm trying to figure out how to answer that question in the most polite way. And so I'll answer it this way with a second story, which sometimes can be thought of as an analogy. While I also was provost at Emory, we acquired the papers of Salman Rushdie, the noted author who produced what was referred to as the Booker Prize books for the last 25 years. And someone asked Salman, why did Emory get your papers? And he looked at them, and a mutual friend of ours in New York, and he says, they asked. And so I think part of the way we got the Woodson papers and the series of other papers that occurred on my watch, I mean, SCLC papers, Alice Walker papers, and the others, we went about asking. And as I was telling Bernice, one of my colleagues at Emory at that time literally had dumpster divers all over the United States. I mean, this was part of the thing that not everyone understands the value of what's in their attic or what's in their possession. And so every time we had word that there was an organization about to go out of business or maybe closing down, we actually sent people to see if they were throwing away papers. And along the way, we acquired some gems. But it also put us in contact with a network of individuals who actually understood the value of the historical record. And the old notion was, if it wasn't written, it didn't exist. And so we actually built on that idea that part of our responsibility as a major research university is to make sure that which has been written, we can recover and we can preserve and make available for all of humankind. And that was actually an awesome responsibility and duty. And one of my favorite parts about that job was my colleague who led that effort at Emory. He was the first person to come to Michigan. I was the dean of the graduate school at the University of Michigan at that point before I moved. And he came to my office and he said to me, he said, we've known each other a long time. We're going to be really good buddies when you come to Atlanta. I say, why? He says, because I have the ideas and you have the checkbook. And it turned out to be a very fruitful relationship, I can say, for both the institution and for all. You know, I had a talk, and as I was saying to Burns, I had a talk that I was going to give, and it was a talk about African-American history and thinking about Carter Woodson and understanding what it meant to actually be a strategic visionary and looking ahead and realizing you build organizations one person at a time, one set of relationships at a time, and that if indeed there's this organic material that can compound and become something else, you actually create an institution, and that institution endures beyond you. And that really is, in some ways, the measure of what it means to lead. How do you actually imagine not only what you can accomplish in your life, but can you actually produce something that creates an enduring legacy? And it's the power of then the individual as leader, but that individual as leader in community. And when you look at the story of Carter G. Woodson, this native in way of Huntington, West Virginia, you're reminded that we are here in 2016. He died in 1950, and we're still not only thinking about him and talking about him, but actually continuing to build upon what he imagined was true, which is that the story of American history, that project we call American democracy, is an incomplete one if you actually leave out vital parts of the chapter. And that by producing African-American history in the way that he did, working with K-12, working with other kinds of partners in this, he understood that he was not only just then coming and filling in gaps, but he was actually helping us to better understand that American project. And so I was going to give us, I have prepared a talk here, and that sort of builds on that. And I'm trying to decide, do I give that talk or I give another one? Because it's not quite like the last time I gave a talk after dinner and wine and all. I did one a few years ago at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. It was 9:30 at night, and they asked me to come up and speak. And I said, you know, realize it's 10:30 in my body clock. And we had had a huge feast. And I'm thinking, how do you actually make sure that everyone stay with me? And I know you won't have that problem. But let me see if I actually can't weave together the two stories, the one that I told that night and the one I was going to tell tonight. Tonight's story actually stems from a conversation I had with Bernard Lafayette. I don't know how many of you may know Bernard. Yeah, so Bernard became a friend when I lived in Atlanta. And he is, for those who know him, a longtime civil rights activist, an educator, and a propagator of nonviolence. And he told me one time that, you know, you professional historians, you mostly get the story right about the civil rights movement. But along the way, you miss the full essence of what occurred during the American civil rights movement. And I said, what do you mean? He says, well, in your concern for social movements and their associated theories, in your accounting of showdowns with intransigent Southern hardliners, in your attention to charismatic leaders and iconic events, you forget we were strategists. That what we went about and we changed the nature of American life because we were strategists. And that piece should be the central part of the story of the telling of the civil rights chapter in African American history. Now, I hired Bernard to come and spend 5 years teaching at Emory, and I realized with that came his constant reminder that we professional historians were getting it wrong. And so I've been passing this along to my colleagues for some time. But the more I thought about it, the more I realized, in a long ways, he was right. In our attempt to contextualize this period after World War II, we had indeed focused, perhaps, on not all of the right things. Lafayette, in his critique, called on historians and other scholars to rethink the ways they write about the great American story of democracy. And indeed, especially in the last 20 years, scholars and journalists have found ways in books and in articles and in multimedia presentations to tell an increasingly complicated story about the descendants of enslaved people and their allies. In the process, we have not only learned about the heroines and heroes who burst onto the international stage a decade after the end of World War II, but also peered into organizations and institutions and discovered the importance of coordinated, sustained action. In time, we have come to learn that the battle for civil rights cannot be easily limited to that period 1954 to 1968, the period usually heralded as the civil rights era. As historian Jackie Hall maintained, mindful of scholarship that grew in volume and importance in the 1990s and early 2000s, there was a long civil rights history in the United States, with this culminating summation of activism moving to center stage in the 1950s and 1960s. And while critics have debated the exact periodization, few disagree with the central conclusion that the pursuit of civil rights parallels the history of racial subjugation and a struggle for opportunity in the United States. Yet, for all of the powerful work that has been produced since the late 1960s, often lost in the narrative arc is the broader context that gave form to the events of post-war America. If we need to understand civil rights actors as strategists, we also need to be ever mindful of them as citizens of a changing world. From biography to case study, from grand synthesis to monographs, more and more studies have hinted at a people tied to others seeking relief from social and cultural domination based on color and national origins. On the global stage, this emerges as a story in large measure about ending colonialism. But what linked the global and the local was a prevailing sense by those who chose to act that they could be architects of their destinies. This profound sense of being able to change the world accelerated after World War II, even though earlier antecedents prefigured what was to follow. So the talk that I'm going to give, but I'm going to hint at a couple of other things, this talk stems in some ways from something I wrote a few years ago, a published essay. And in that essay, I centered on three interconnected themes. That essay accepted Lafayette's challenge and described civil rights actors as intellectual strategists. That piece also distinguishes between the modern civil rights era and the history of civil rights in American history, which is a much longer timeline. But it also seeks to remind all that the modern era dovetailed with significant societal changes that occurred not only within our borders, but around the world. And here's sort of the other sort of story that I want to weave in. But when we think about the civil rights and we think that there are these moments of African-American history that sort of build up to one great moment of societal change. And a lot of African-American history that Carter Woodson and others pioneered were also the small little details of life that allowed people to make it from day to day and week to week and year to year. I am a social historian by training. To be honest, I like the second as much as I like the first. I actually like those small little details about life and how people try to figure out who they are and where they fit. So let me introduce the second story and then relate the two in a way. Because the second story is from a book I wrote a few years ago called Love on Trial. And this is one of the most sort of basic pieces about American life. It's about people in love. A woman, Alice Beatrice Jones, who married a guy named, last name Rhinelander, Leonard Rhinelander. Now, the Rhinelanders so happened to be one of the wealthiest families in America at that point in time. And if you go to New York City today, you can still see the remnants of their old mansion on Western Madison Avenue. It's the Ralph Lauren building there, and it's gorgeous. But at that point, Alice ran into this young man, and their story becomes actually the story of tabloids. It's 1925 America. And for those of us who are old enough to remember that moment when we say we were all watching OJ, in 1925 America, they all watched Alice and Leonard. Alice was the child of British immigrants. Her mother and father came to the US in the late 1890s from England. And on their immigration papers, her father is listed as perhaps colored. And her mother is listed as white or Caucasian. Leonard's family, when Leonard and Alice begin dating and eventually he marries, Leonard then is led to divorce Alice on the grounds that he had not knowingly married a colored woman. And in the result is, and this is a story about life and the textures, was then a trial that went on for 2 weeks. And everyone watched. I mean everyone. All the New York tabloids, man, the Daily News, for those of you who spend time in New York and think today's Daily News is something, you should go back and look at the 1920s Daily News. But the New York Times, the Jewish Forward, and several other immigrant ethnic language newspapers, all were trying to figure out, asking this simple question, what was Alice? And Alice was interesting in trying to answer that question because in effect she says, I am whatever you want me to be. And so in the language of 1920s America, we use words like passing. And we use other words to describe how people transgress the boundaries of difference. Alice never used those words. The state, interestingly enough, though, tried to figure out this family that didn't fit into the boxes that we created. And so we think about how we actually understand human action. There's the individuals, and then the state played a role. So Alice had two sisters. One married a guy, Robert Jones, who was from Virginia, who was unquestionably African-American. So when you look at her marriage certificate, she's African American. When you look at the census record, she's African American. Her other sister married a guy who was Italian, who happened to have the nickname of Footsie and last name was Miller, but was nevertheless always said Italian after everything else as a marker. Now, if you go to her marriage certificate, same sister, same family, she's listed as white. You go, okay, so how's this happening in the same community? And so is this the power of patriarchy, in that women will follow the men no matter what? And the state just sort of only recognizes it in those terms. So let's go to Alice. So we went to look for Alice's documents to see, in this community, of all the people who knew, what would Alice be? Well, Alice, at least on her marriage certificate, was also listed as white, as was Leonard. Her father would testify during the court period. My mother was Caucasian and British, that my father was a subject of the British colonies. That's the testimony, and we then try to figure out, how do you begin to understand this story? And that's in a way also the story then of trying to understand the civil rights movement and taking up the words of Bernard Lafayette. You hit little fragments here and fragments there. How do you begin and then tease out a larger story to make sense of? The earliest book in the civil rights era that came out was actually a biography of Martin Luther King Jr., written by David Levering Lewis. Some of you may know Lewis for a beautiful set of biographies of W.E.B. Du Bois that won the Pulitzer Prize. But he took his first step at biography in 1970. When he wrote this somewhat hagiographic account of Martin. But the scholarship would catch up eventually as more documents and more fragments of the story became more available. As David Garrow and others discovered that there was something called COINTELPRO, and that the FBI and others had been following King for a long, long time, that some of the things that were attributed to him actually were the result of state action and state actors. That begins to change some ways in which we look at the historical actor as we become more knowledgeable and more evidence is brought to bear. Some of it changed in the literature and historiography for at least civil rights as the theory itself began to evolve. And we moved away from just a charismatic leader approach and this notion that events happen because of charismatic leaders. I can remember teaching circa 1990, and I had a number of students who would come to me and say, oh, Professor Lewis, if only I had lived then. And I said, what would have happened? I would have been on the front lines of here and there. And I said, well, you got the lines now. Are you there? I said, you know, it's always funny to me because there are more people who were at the March on Washington than ever could have been at the March on Washington. They remember it differently now in hindsight. There were more people who were involved in local demonstrations than any photos that we can produce and any eyewitness accounts would attest. As if they want to say, I didn't really want to miss that moment in history. And maybe I can rewrite myself back into it. And you find yourselves, and so our theories about how we actually think about how to interpret African American history began to move in the 1980s with books like the ones by Alden Morris and others that began to really tell a different story. And Morris writing about the organizing principle and the ways, and mobilizing principle, the ways in which communities mobilize. And we're reminded that before there was Montgomery, that was Baton Rouge in 1953. And that Montgomery actually followed on a series of communities. Before we had the bus boycotts in Montgomery, that were bus boycotts in Norfolk, Virginia during World War II. I mean, these stories and ways when we began to sort of fill in the backstory to realize that there was a mobilizing tradition in black communities that predate 1954, 1955. And that there were individuals who were willing to challenge the assumptions that were known. That it's impossible to talk about Brown 1 and Brown 2. And I jokingly said to my mother years later, I was born just in time for Brown 2, 1955, which meant I got to go to segregated schools in Virginia for another 15 years. But that notion of all deliberate speed, which is perhaps one of the most ironic phrases in American constitutional law and history, came to mean something in particular. But that's not to say that Hasty and Marshall and Houston and Greenwood and Carter and all of those lawyers who were fighting on the front lines weren't actually trying to change things, because they were. It's not to say that people like the Briggs, Harry and Liza Briggs, didn't imagine that they couldn't change things by actually becoming part of the group of parents across the nation that wound up in the Brown decision. I mean, the Briggs knew that they were challenging the status quo in Clarendon, South Carolina, when they decided to pursue the case. And they did so in part because, as Harry would say years later, we figured anything to better the children's conditions was worthwhile. And that it cost him his job and his livelihood and his security, but he realized that he had the power to make a difference. And that was part of what our scholarship is catching up to and understanding. And it's that movement from an Alden Morris attempt at mobilizing tradition to go back to something then that Bernard Lafayette would say, it was not just mobilizing, it was organizing. Because organizing was part of an overall set of strategies that were being played out day in and day out. And so Charles Payne's very, very important book, Charles is a historical sociologist, entitled I've Got the Light of Freedom, the Organizing Tradition in the Mississippi Freedom Struggle. And where Charles would write this book then and go on to really document the men and women who came back from World War II, determined to organize, and if necessary in Mississippi, to give their lives, to try to move from the here and now to where we want to be. It's the Mega Evers story of sure, but it's not just Mega, it's a whole range of others who are part of this organizing tradition. And so the scholarship keeps moving along as we begin to ask new kinds of questions and imagine new ways of interpreting the evidence that's available. And that's important. Is important because what you end up then doing is seeing the actors themselves in a new light. It's how Barbara Ransby, in her biography of Ella Baker, award-winning biography of Ella Baker, talks about Ella Baker as not just an intellectual, but an organic intellectual, who read Gramsci and Ferrer, but also learned from the people on the corners and in the communities that she actually interacted with. That she was not above the community, or distant from the community, that she was learning in partnership. For those of you who know the Ella Baker story, Ella was in about 30 different organizations all over the United States, fighting for everything from Puerto Rican independence to the end of apartheid to other causes, because she saw herself as what happens in improvements in conditions in the United States were tied to improvements for people of color all over the world. And she had that sense and sensibility, and that this was sort of part of the story as well. It is that ability then, in thinking about Carter Woodson and where we started, and recognizing the progression in the ways in which then the scholarship, using civil rights as an example, continued to evolve. Let me switch back again a little bit to the Rhinelander story. It's also then trying to tease out in how we understand someone like Alice. Because Alice was to believe that in her world, operating as she did in New Rochelle, New York in the 1920s, she should be able to define herself not by the social definitions imposed in governmental documents. That's not who she was. She was the daughter of British immigrants. She had a brother-in-law who was Italian and a brother-in-law who was African-American. And that was her family. And that family should be able to actually stand for itself. It's not unlike, in some ways, the more recent work that's come out on the Lovings, right? I mean, my favorite of all sort of historical cases in 20th century American history. But what more beautiful thing than a case on interracial love than called Loving? And you saw the piece there, where this couple gets married in Washington, D.C., only to return to their native Virginia and to be told that their expression of family values was out of step with the nation's notion of family values. But they persevered, and we know the story. In 1967, the Supreme Court ruled that they were right and we have been wrong for a long, long time. It's those pieces of taking them together for us then as scholars and historians and going back to Carter Woodson and imagining how do we purpose and ask new questions of our era. Are there new ways to look at old evidence and see something that we hadn't seen before? In the Rhinelander case, it is. It's a way to actually begin to say, so what made for 1920s America, right? Alice and Leonard met because of the automobile. Literally, Leonard's car stopped in front of her house one day, and he's trying to figure out how to get it started. She walks out. And it's this notion of mobility, an automobile that leads to a chance encounter. And then he sees this smartly dressed young woman, and she sees this guy, a chapbook who has some means, and something happens. Maybe it's a little spark. It certainly ended up as a love story. And as part of the case, what was fascinating then is the nature of their love is put on trial. And finally, Alice's lawyer at some point turns to Leonard, who by all accounts was the world's worst witness. He filed to have the marriage annulled on the grounds that he had not knowingly married a colored woman. And so it was a civil case, but it became one where it was a jury trial. And finally, the lawyer looked at him, Alice's lawyer, and said, Mrs. Rhinelander, do you see well? Do you see Robert Jones and you see these other members of the family? Never crossed your mind they were African American. Leonard didn't have a really good answer to that question. Because in some ways, what we also come to realize in this story is another complicated story. It's a story about family and privilege, right? We could read this story through the lens of race alone. But Leonard had two options. He could stay with Alice and forfeit his access to money and privilege. Or he could dissolve his relationship with Alice, remain a Rhinelander, and keep contact with his father's millions of dollars. He chose the latter. And I'll fast forward so I can come back to the civil rights case. In the end, as we meaning Heidi Artizon and I wrote this book, Heidi had been one of my doctoral students at the University of Michigan. Alice, in the end, agreed. Well, she won the court case. I mean, so I'll fast forward. She won the court case. I mean, it's like, even this jury in New Rochelle was like, no. In 1925, you had to have known, period. So Leonard would eventually, a few years later, move off to Nevada, and he would work out a divorce settlement with Alice from Nevada. And as part of the settlement, she was to forfeit any further use of a Rhinelander name. And in return, she would get an annuity for the rest of her life. She lived a long time. She lived until 1989. Leonard did not live that long. He died in the 1930s in an accident. And for that period, everything we could find, Heidi and I could find, said that she was a faithful participant in the settlement. She did not reclaim the Rhinelander name. She became Alice Beatrice Jones again. She never remarried. She had no children. And that became her fate. And then the beauty of doing research, and this is sort of part of trying to tell stories from the little fragments. I get a call from Heidi one day. She says, "Earl, I'm at the cemetery." I say, "What cemetery?" She says, "Where Alice is born." And all, he says, "You won't believe what I just found." Alice reclaimed, she got the last word. She reclaimed the round letter name and it's there on her headstone. There was no one to debate it any longer, no one to challenge. And so you cannot find an Alice Beatrice Jones, but you will find an Alice J. Rhinelander. And so you know, we speculate and open to questions. What do you do with that headstone? What does it tell you? Is this about getting even? Is it about the fact that, you know, this was a love affair for life, and I get to reclaim it in the end? Is this a way in which, you know, I signed those papers and I got the annuity, you know, for all these years, but I will get the last word here. And so it's a power play. Or is it something else? And that's the part of going from the period when Carter Woodson began Black History Month and to now, where we started with facts and dates and moments, and we're trying to write African American history into the American story to say we belong. And people should take note and that we're important. Now, 3 generations later, we get to say, but we're more than important. You can't understand human history. And you can't understand the ways in which people write themselves in the history without viewing it through these multiple lenses. And we offer you a lens to understand the American context and American life more fully. We see that played out in the civil rights historiography as well. Because we would go from the theorizing about organizing and all down to then the ways in which, and by the 1990s and 2000s, we were looking at new actors. And we were telling the stories of the men and women who marched on Washington as part of a Poor People's Campaign. And we talk about welfare workers and the ways in which people who we think of as not always being able to claim the mantle of dignity and respect had themselves a sense of an organizing tradition as they tried to assert their place on the American landscape. We see it in the ways in which we think of something, how Detroit became Motown. And for a whole generation, it's impossible to think about the U.S. without thinking about a whole range of songs, from A Ball of Confusion, which is still one of, as I'm navigating the subways in New York City some days, I just have to put it on because it still seems quite appropriate, down to, you know, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. And there's a range of ways in which we wrote history into the music becomes a different way. And so now we're looking at sort of cultural history on top of social history, on top of political history, on top of economic history, to begin to sort of tell the story of African Americans. That actually is an interesting way that we think about Carter Woodson. Carter Woodson was a visionary and a strategist in his own right. Bernard Lafayette invited all of us, invited me to think about how we write about civil rights history as one of strategy. But as we have watched the evolution of African American history over the last 70, 80, 90 years, we've also come to see it as something else. It's a story about America. And I have often written and often said, you cannot actually tell the American story absent the story of African Americans. Think of it this way. In 2019, we will remember 1619, 400 years ago in Jamestown. In 2019, we begin the story of the importation of the first people of African descent who were indentured in the U.S., and that system in indentureship turned into chattel slavery. 400 years. That so happens that year I'll be the president of the Organization of American Historians. And our convention will be in Philadelphia. And I'm imagining a broad conversation about freedom and the ways in which we talk about and trace the story of freedoms and freedom in American life. Carter Woodson, Marshall University, and the work that you've undertaken is part then of that effort to begin to say, we can't run away from our past. We have to do more than embrace our past. We have to interrogate our past, and we have to be responsible for it. I'm always reminded at this point, and I used to say this to my students all the time, the beauty of history is that you get to see how people claim their own rights to be the architects of their own destiny. We get, again, by the ways in which we actually write about African Americans, to reclaim some sense of that destiny. I applaud you for your work in making sure that now, not only are there proclamations and statements in the congressional record, but there's actual work on the ground. Because in a way, that's the story of history. It's a day-to-day work, the small pieces, where sometimes you can't measure progress by how far you move, but how you sense your relationship to the other. Thank you.